are gone. We give thanks to God. We give thanks to God. We give thanks to God for those maimed through the evil of Mother Teresa. Those dead we treasure. We pray for those most closely affected by her death. Among them, Trevor,
the sheep.
Lord, we thank you for the precious gift of the sick, the maimed, and all whose lives are damaged. And for the strength we draw from all who are weak, poor, and powerless in this country and throughout the world. Lord, we commend to you Elizabeth, our Queen, whose death may serve the common good. We give thanks above all for her readiness to identify with God Almighty and for the way she gave source to so many people. Her mother, her brother, don't defy it, and many, many, many more. We pray for the royal family as they discharge their members in Trevor Rees-Jones and give them aids. Lord of landmines, hear our prayer. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is
heads, tails, both, but coin then lands on third side, the inside. Then fly, so wingish speed, then thwack, in half be glass, and broke beak slumbling ground or quiver pigeon, while rattles rub hands in the shadow. Sing so full with bursting soul, ye heart fly out of mouth, and then bashed be bit by all with ears, who cry, shut, shut, shut it up, and cackle nothing. With woof welcome, in Blue Jam.
Muscles under the arm there and lifted a quite awkward leg.
Yeah.
That was all right until this morning. I woke up and can't move the shoulder at all now.
So. Right. It's just right here.
Yeah.
I see. Right. Well, what do you think I'm going to do with this? I'm going to do it on the phone. Okay.
Just stay there while I go next door.
I'll move through and you pick up the phone.
Okay.
Right. I'll speak to you later. Where the pain is. Philip, could you just hang on a moment? Could you keep your voice down? Because I can hear you through the door. So, when did this happen? Oh, good. Sorry, and this isn't a very good line. But why don't you call me back? Yeah, it's 302. Hello, Bob Greenhill. Arts Centre. Sorry, who's this? Poor me. Well, I can't see you now, I'm with a patient. Look, is this an emergency?
Well, then come in on Thursday morning.
Could you
hang on a minute? I'm on the phone. Could you just wait outside? Herbert? Oh, there you are. Right, 10 o'clock on Thursday, okay? Good. Okay, well, I'll see you then. And can you go to the reception next time? I'm not the secretary. Right, bye-bye.
So, what's the story?
I have to come back Thursday.
I was just wondering if you could just...
Not 10 o'clock.
In the ignition, and I look, I cannot bloody believe it. The car is only 4 foot long. I said, what's this? He goes, it's your car. I said, what do you mean it's my fucking car? He said, oh, that's what it was like when you dragged it in here. And I said, don't fuck me about. How do I drive that in? It's only 2'6" tall. And he goes, you must have put on some weight. Man! Then the manager comes out, he said, what the fuck's going on here? I said, I paid good money for this. He goes, what's wrong with it? I said, what do you mean, what's fucking wrong with it? I said, look at the size of it. He goes, what? I said, it's only about 4 fucking foot long. What the fuck have you done to it? Then he says, oh, well, that's how it came in. He goes, I particularly remember that one because I used to have one myself. A fucking 4 foot Vauxhall cartload, fucking yes. I said, is that it? I said, is that what I have to drive away? And I said, it's your car, take it or leave it, it's up to you. So I just had to fucking squeeze into it, didn't I? He knees round my ears. And it's 4 fucking foot car, it's only 2'6" tall. I mean, what am I, fucking nodding? Fucking nodding?
Sitting in the armchair again. Occasionally he looked at the telly. Mostly he was looking at me looking at the telly. Rothko didn't want me there. There in Imogen's house that I was supposed to be looking after. I looked at him now. A big Irish wolfhound. Deep dark eyes. In one I could see Imogen telling me to take him for walks, but not to let him off the lead as he hadn't been squirrel trained. And in the other I saw me, saying yes and don't lose the keys like you did last time, you worthless little prick. God, your mother hates you. My brother was there over my shoulder. I double-locked the front door and looked at the keys. What shall we do with these? I said to Rothko. He looked quizzical, Probably better to leave them safe in there, isn't it? I said, and posted them back through the door. Now don't lose the dog. I made a noose with the hand end of the lead and looped it round my own neck. I had to stoop slightly, but I figured the knob of my head would stop us ever becoming separated. So we clattered to the park, Rothko galloping ahead, me stumbling behind like a bear running too fast down a hill. 20 yards into the park, Rothko glimpsed the duck pond and bolted. I landed in the shallows as Rothko closed his jaws on the nearest mallard. He shook his head violently so its quacks were broken like the honks of a goose in a cement mixer. The little girl was crying, "Help the ducky." I dripped stupidly. The girl's dad grabbed the duck and snapped at the dog's nose, whimpering, "Stop it, and this is appalling." He was clearly the sort of sensitive man that Rothko had no respect for. They separated with a splash, and so did the duck. The man stared dumbly at the legs in his hand, and suddenly everyone was screaming RSPCA. The lead snapped tight around my neck as Rothko dodged a blow, and the world became purple and banging. Through the rumble, I could hear my own strangled peanut of a voice screeching, "No, no, please, it's the dog, and it's not mine, it's Imogen Edwards's." Rothko turned to me with curled lips. "Imogen's not going to be happy with you at all," he said. Before I had time to gawk, he flew past me towards the park gate. "Leg it, you fat fuck," he laughed. I followed him in the noxic blaze. People were running after us. A bus was pulling off 20 yards from the gate. I overtook the dog and launched us into the old lady's please section. He leapt onto the seat beside me. "What the fuck is this?" he said. "I only go in taxis. You can't expect me to look after your legal case in these conditions." "Legal case," I said. He eyed me directly. "Just think about all the things that you've been doing wrong. Someone's got to defend them." A tiny electric fugue of panic. I began to recall the time when I was 7 and a gerbil had started swearing at me. Amongst other things, it had told me that my dad was having an affair. I had told my mum, and soon afterwards the family had split up. "Are you the gerbil?" I said. "Now you're losing it," he replied. "Yes," said the conductor. "I have no money." "Ask him if we can pay on account," said Rothko. "Can we pay on account?" I said. The conductor eyed me suspiciously. "Pay your fare now or get off." "Tell him you'll only pay if he can prove you will definitely get to the next stop," said Rothko. I did. The conductor looked at me as if his mother had just walked out of my nose. "Tell him I'm a lawyer," the dog said. I knew I shouldn't, but I did that too. At the next stop, we were shown a pavement. I looked at Rothko. "Why are you talking?" I said. "Dogs don't talk." "So why are you asking me?" he replied. "Don't try to be clever," I said. "No, I am being clever." "Well, that's ridiculous," I said, "because you're only a dog." "Well, if I am only a dog, then you should be able to answer my question easily." I know about panic attacks. I know I have to find something very mundane and ordinary to do to talk myself down. "Have some tea," said the dog. I know that," I said. The cafe was full of people smoking and eating bacon and eggs. The dog sat down next to me. He turned to me and said, "I want a full English breakfast." "Stop freaking me out," I muttered. His lip curled with disdain. "Get me some fucking breakfast, pickle pants." Then a new voice. "Get that dog off my seat." The cafe lady was angry. "Tell that fat cow I sit in a seat every day of my life and I'm not shifting now," said the dog. "Are you going to get him off?" asked the woman more angrily. "I'm very sorry," I said. "He says he's my lawyer, but I'm still not sure. However, I don't want to risk throwing my lawyer onto the floor, bearing in mind the number of things I've done wrong." She glowered. I felt a situation happening, but I didn't know where it was coming from. "Are you angry with me because he just called you a fat cow?" I said. In the street, Rothko called me a hapless tit. He told me he had an empty stomach and was now unlikely to get a single detail of my case correct. I said I didn't care because since I'd known he was my lawyer, things had only got worse. Our bickering turned to swearing as we levelled with the church gate. A family was getting out of a car. Rothko cheered up when he saw this. That little girl has got a snotty hanky in her pocket, he said, and tugged me towards her. Why couldn't I control anything? The little girl squeaked with delight as Rothko stuck his nose in her pocket. Her mother patted him on the head and asked me how old he was. The dog said he was 5. He says he's 5, but in fact he's 7, I said. The mother looked at me and decided I was joking. Rothko rooted for the hanky, but the pocket was small. Sorry about him, I said. He's not a very good dog, but he's an even worse lawyer. The father smiled politely and urged them towards the church. Leave them now, I said. The little girl turned back. Rothko made to follow. Look, if you don't stop this now, you're fired, I shouted. The family were looking at me now. I knew it was bad for people to see me threatening to sack a dog, so I repeated myself, but this time in dog language. The father shook his head sadly and whisked his family inside. It was a christening. The tissue girl and her parents had joined the others round the font. A priest was holding a baby over the water, and the baby was shrieking like ripping metal. I can do that, said Rothko, and began to howl idiotically. Shh, I said, and tried to hide it with a cough. Is there a problem back there? Asked the priest. A fat drumming now in my skull cheeks. You're ruining this christening, I said. It's not me, it's you, said the dog. What? Well, I only came in here so you could seek forgiveness from God. What for? For what you're about to do, said the dog, and looked me straight in the eye. I felt sick as diesel. Is something wrong? Said the priest. Say there is, said the dog. There is, I mumbled. All eyes turned to me. What? Hot iron in my nose. Look at the baby, said the dog. I looked at the baby. Its head swiveled towards me. Then it screamed. Tell them my mother is a whore and the priest fiddles with children. Oh, now look what you've done, I said to the dog. I've seen his notes, said the dog. It's true, you must tell them. What's the problem, said the priest. Ball lightning in my stomach. The baby still staring at me. Go on. You rummaged the kid's pants and she receives the cocks of paying men. The priest's mouth fell open. The baby said, sucker. His father started towards me. The baby told me, I stammered. Rothko lurched towards the little girl who was waving her tissue. The baby's father grabbed me by the neck. The dog leapt. The girl's mother plucked her from the floor and the dog clattered into the priest, knocking the baby from his hands. The baby's mother screamed. The father released my neck and spun towards his wife. I looked at the dog. Ha ha, you're doing all this, he laughed, and grabbed the tissue from the girl's hand. The baby was still in the air. I looked at the dog again. What the fuck do I do now? Don't ask me, I'm only a dog, said the dog, and pelted down the nave, through the porch, down the path, and straight into the road where he slapped into a van, staggered around, and fell over. Manic birdsong. I dropped to my knees in the road. Blood oozed from his mouth. I can't defend you now, you know, he said. Sparrows singing the Dies Irae. Could you recommend someone, I asked. Try the baby. Oh yes, he said, and smiled. Then he went quite quiet and still. I managed to crawl back to Imogen's house. The baby had not been much use, but its father had given some advice to the soft tissues in my face and groin. I lay outside her front door and wondered what to do. The best thing will be to write a note, I said to myself. I'll write a note and explain everything. My note said,
thanks for Imogen. Sorry about the dog. The duck was in bits. Thank you. The thing was talking as well, but told me not to say, but I followed it. The cars did it. The keys are in the wrong half. I went away. It's all right, please. Rothko? Rothko? Rothko!
I know that's what I meant, because I just found the note in my pocket. Here's another. This one's to me. It's from the dead dog. It's a very angry note. Here's one from the dog's mother now. She's even crosser. I don't go to the park now. The ducks tell everyone things about me. They tell everyone I thought a dog could talk. Shut up, I said, when they did, but they didn't. And I hate them now. The ducks.
How do I say your name again?
Martin.
Martin. I think the headaches have a lot to do with the posture at the computer. Can I just look at your tongue? Yes. Do you get cold fingertips?
Yes, sometimes.
I'll just take your pulse. The spleen is damp. Have you had acupuncture before?
No.
It's important for patients to relax fully before I start treatment. Otherwise it can be a bit distressing. Just put your wrist down by your side. You may feel a little tingle when I put this on you. I use are between 9 and 14 inches long and half an inch thick. They must go through the body part and at least 2 inches into the table. Otherwise the patient will slide off and I prop them against the wall. Have
you had it all?
No, won't you?
Okay. Now, what I'm going to do, Martin, is prop you up on the ball. You might feel a little uncomfortable because you're taking the weight of your body on those nails through your lungs. So you might want to try and just push down a bit. Often I'll leave several patients together along the walls half an hour. They're usually concentrating too much on themselves to notice anything else. No, Martin, I'm just going to give your stomach nails a little tweak. Can you feel that? This one? Good. Sorry. Oh, Sarah's fainted. You're right. Yeah, that's quite normal.
Hi, Sarah.
I think the treatment is very successful.
Deep breaths, everyone.
I've never had a patient.
patient come back. We have difficulty getting some of them to leave under their own steam. Just have to leave them out the back. They've normally gone in the morning.
Sir. he mention to Jill how much Ted liked his Lego? He's made a great spaceship.
Don't worry, because it said 8 to 10 year olds on the board.
Yeah, but he's pretty bright for a 6-year-old. Incidentally, did he come home from school today?
About 6 hours ago.
That's odd, isn't it?
Maybe
I
should call someone.
Nah. You probably just decided to stay overnight at the school.
Ted? No. Haven't seen him for about 2 weeks. Yeah. Well, if you see him, tell him to pop home. Okay. See you Friday. Dinner with Simon on Friday.
Can I
book a babysitter? Nah. He's not going to turn up now. Don't you suppose he thought we were picking him up from school?
Maybe I'd better give Mrs. Hill a call and just check if he's been standing outside for a couple of minutes. Good idea. Hello, hi. Is it Sue Belgium here? Just calling about Ted and Pound 3? We just wondered if he'd be hanging around outside the school waiting to be picked up. Really? She saw a bloke pick him up. Yeah. Handled him quite roughly.
And the man had a car?
Yeah. Oh, right.
Good.
Yes.
It was horribly rainy.
Yes.
Do you think the man knew about his ex was?
Yeah. Sorry, Mrs. Hill, you don't know if this man knew that Ted was on Goat's Milk Avenue, do you? No, just wondered. So he really bundled him into a bag. Yes, yes. Okay, well thanks a lot. Yeah, will do. Bye-bye.
Sounds like we'll find it in the woods then. I'll get some of the lads to have a look on Saturday morning. Yeah, Mike? David? Alright. How's Jill? Yeah? Yeah, we'll have to do that again. Listen, Mike, are you watching the match in the pub on Saturday? You couldn't join me and someone that likes to crawl around the woods before kick-off. Yeah, Ted's gone missing. About 2 weeks. He was picked up from school by some dodgy-sounding bloke. Can you do that? Oh, great. Bring a spade. Yeah, about 2 o'clock. Great. Cheers. Well, I don't know if he'll have been buried or just been left out.
Easy if he's been left out.
Yeah, fucking not easy. Speaking. Oh, have you? Right. They found a body, like. Yeah. Yeah, can't really come over this evening. Sometime next week? Who wants to go over and identify him? Yes, could you bring him over? Well, they're just doing something at the moment. What about banging him in a car? Alright.
What about his glasses?
Oh, yeah. Has he got blue plastic framed glasses on? Oh, well, I'm pretty sure that's him then. Blue frames. Make him look rather studious, yeah. Sounds like him. Well, that's good enough for us, yeah. So, what do you do now? Chuck him away? Can't you just... Yeah, I suppose. Alright, well, we'll see what we can do. Okay. Thanks a lot. Cheers. We'll have to pick him up and bury him.
Did he say what he'd been doing?
Well, it sounds like he was buggered quite a lot, but it's fine. Yeah, apparently it was that bloody Mike Holland that did it. I'll work with him next time I see him.
Well, it's nothing to do with them.
Well, yeah,
suggest that you do try and they'll be able to help you.
What, are you saying that the cable company is sending us lizards?
Yes.
What?
By mistake. Lizards.
Hang on, look, mate. It's quite simple. You sold us the telly, yeah? You delivered it, you set it up, and it starts pouring lizards, right? So we want you to come up with a solution. It's quite simple.
Sweep them up!
Yes.
Don't you sweep them up, then?
No, you sweep them up.
What?
As I keep saying, nothing, they've really nothing to do with me.
Is that all you can say? Is it? It's nothing to do with me, is that it?
Wipe.
What? Now look here, this is fucking ridiculous, right? I'll swear. I'm fucking nuts if I want to, right?
No need
for that. What will your head office say, right, when I tell him about your uselessness at customer relations, eh?
Yeah.
What was that?
What did you say? You did it. They said it.
What?
Why can you do this? Why do you think you said it?
I told you that the lizards started coming out of the telly as soon as you set it up, right?
You said
right. I'm going to fucking get you sat, mate. And that is no threat. That's a promise, right? What's your name? Stop fucking me about! Come on, what is it?
Right, what's your boss's name?
Another Mr. Lizard.
Shut up! Fucking stop it!
Mr. Lizard.
You come back in here! Fucking you think you're doing? Fucking come out! Come out! Come on, stop! Fucking come out!
Shh. Come on now. Shh.
Also goes round the back as well.
Right.
And I feel dizzy quite a lot.
How are your ears?
Oh, yeah, okay.
Right. And how big's your mouth?
Sorry?
I'll need to have a look at your old chap.
Oh, me?
Yes.
Well, has it something to do with it?
Yes. Get down there, let's have a look. Swing your hips. Make it slap against your thighs. Good solid mass. At double the speed. Good.
Not sure.
Keep going. No,
my lord. It's nice. But not the same. Keep going. Kind of more slinky.
Stop now.
This is quite important. Do you understand what I'm doing?
No.
I'm piecing together a holistic puzzle. Now, could you just keep that going? Hello, Sarah. Yes, could you ask Dr. Blazing to watch it? Thanks.
Please, can I stop now?
No, just keep swinging, or jump up and down. Ah, yes, that's powerful. Do that too much, it'll swing right up your ass. I'm going to come up my ass as well. Ah, Alison, look at this. Keep going, I'm going to pass. Synchronized cocks. They've almost got the same log rate. Harmony of knobs.
Necessary.
Not particularly.
Oh.
You two keep my phone. Pants first.
Bloody hell.
Is it Nick?
Nick Foster.
Just pop through the waiting room, Nick, and we'll fix you up in a moment, okay? Michael, this has got to stop.
Has it?
Yes.
He didn't mind.
He was furious.
Was he?
You're going to get into trouble.
Yeah. Well, I suppose you're right.
If you want to talk about it, I've always got time.
Yeah. Thanks, Alice.
It's okay. See you later.
Alison.
Yeah.
I've probably got about 3 more goes at this before I get recorded, haven't I?
No.
Please?
No.
Please?
2 more.
Oh, thanks.
Okay, Jerry, got me loud and clear?
Yes.
Right, we're on. Jerry Springer, welcome.
Well, thanks. Nice to meet you.
Okay, now, Jerry, tell us your name.
Jerry Springer.
Are you bigger than your name?
Well, I'm just a schlub that has a show.
wait a minute, hang on, you do present perhaps the best talk TV show in the world, certainly one of the most successful in the States, and that I gather has just gone to number one.
Yeah, it's now number one, but yeah, it's doing really good now, but, you know, because it's hot, and it's kind of new, and it's incredibly outrageous, so people are taking notice.
So is it going to get more outrageous?
Well, I think it's impossible to be, I mean, outrageous is outrageous, there aren't degrees of it.
Somebody said outrageous is as outrageous does, and when it does, it doesn't, when it gets to the end.
Yeah.
So when you go on your show,
yes.
One of the things I've noticed is that you are moving from side to side.
Right.
Now, that is one of the elements of genius. Why did you choose to do that?
Yeah, I just keep walking around and I'm watching what's going on. I try not to be the focal point of the show.
A lot of people just come forward into the camera.
Yeah.
Is the lateral movement something to do with the modesty or what?
I guess I never thought of it in those psychological terms, but I suspect, I just...
I mean, was that your idea?
Well, I guess. No one ever told me. I just kind of walk around.
Is that sort of a pendulum thing? What's going on?
Right. I like to be back with the audience. I don't want to be on the stage.
We don't really know who you are.
Right.
It's kind of like, wait a minute, is that guy standing up? I know, he's the guy with the mic.
That's exactly right.
One of the things that these idiots over here don't do is a decent warm-up act. You do one, don't you?
Yeah, I go out there just to, you know, warm up the audience, tell some silly
jokes. To warm them up, I guess.
Yeah.
Now, is part of that to warm them up? So what sort of things do you say to them?
I just, you know, I go in there and I tell them that, we were out in LA recently and taping a show, and for 2 hours this gorgeous woman was banging on my hotel door. Well, finally I let her out.
Right, now that male will think that she's on the outside.
Yeah.
Because the woman was on the wrong side of the door.
There you go.
Okay. Now, I want to let you meet the spunk of the show, which is the guests, right?
Yes,
now,
that's it.
I wonder which sort of stories you would and wouldn't do. I mean, at the moment, you're quite prepared to do anything to be outrageous.
We don't do anything.
So what'd you do? I fell in love with a guy who shot my husband.
Yes. Okay. That's outrageous, don't you agree?
It's terrible. What did you do? I fell in love with a guy who was shooting me. Brackets, it was horny as the bullets went inside of me.
It was horny as the bullets. Who was horny?
The woman found it sexually attractive in some way. Yes?
You've got it. Well,
yes?
It's outrageous.
It's outrageous.
Okay. As long as it's outrageous, it gets on.
I fell in love with a guy who shot my kids. It's outrageous. I'm glad it was something to do with the blood on the screen.
As I said.
Okay, so that's a yes. I fell in love with a guy who shot my kids.
I'm saying anything that is outrageous is yes.
My doctor fingers my kids up the ass.
Anything that is outrageous is on the show.
Would you even have
given me a list?
Give
me a list of something that's normal, and then I'll say no, that doesn't belong on the show.
My husband's a schizo, he keeps beating himself up about it.
I don't know how many times I have to answer your question.
Would you say yes?
Right.
What I want to know is, what really gets you down in this life of ours? People suffering from Pash Cranes, Jubosa, I mean, that's horrible. All the industrial diseases, the people poisoned by tosphates and buggerites. I mean, some of them even lose use of their necks.
Diseases are always sad.
Horrible. These children losing their ability to use their thoughts. When they have them, they just can't use them.
Yeah, you know, I mean, there's great pain in the world. One of the crises of life is that, and it isn't fair.
We haven't talked about a final thought.
Okay.
Yeah, now they're very important in the show.
Yeah.
Where does the inspiration for that come from?
I used to do it when I was doing the news.
If you had to sum up the situation with Saddam Hussein, Bill Clinton.
I think my notion there is that Saddam is clearly a danger to his own people as well as the surrounding nations. But I don't think what we ought to do at this point is to kill more innocent people just to get him at this point.
Right.
If there's a way to remove him without killing innocent people, then obviously I'm in favor of that. I don't know that anyone has found out exactly how to do that, but I think we should still try.
And so when you write that down, say, it actually turns into something that makes sense, yeah?
there.
Thank you.
was perfect. Yeah, I know they already hate me. Nobody's perfect. I know that nobody's perfect. Yeah, I guess that nobody hates me.
Fear right now is definitely getting the gush.
As a director, I've seen the gush close up, and it's not pretty. The guy just gets locked into an ejaculation and doesn't stop until he's dead.
First guy that ever was, forget it, was Dean Dawson. I've seen the kid. He's doing the snot shot. And suddenly, there's this real panic on his face. And he just keeps staring down at himself and he's whipping, oh my God, oh my God. And it's like a sad voice, freaking clown. He's coming with tears in his voice, but they're not there. But it is bad.
I threw ice on his balls. Tried to de-stimulate him with a dog carcass.
It took him 3 days to die. And all the time he was firing the fuck juice and he was begging to be shot.
Spunk expert explained to me that the whole body just gets consumed in producing semen. You can eat all day and all night, but you can't keep up when you're shooting the moisturizer like a fucked up oil rig.
He was just 20 kilos when he died. That is maybe about as big as two or three squirrels. Cremated him. They couldn't burn his testicles.
Gosh, you're suddenly in big demand for crimsons all over town. There are special agents for it. You see a black limo with a flashing light and a siren. Chances are that's a jam waiting with some poor kid in the back, groin going off like a sick snake. Gosh agent, clutching a supply of thick khakis, trying to cram in as many jobs as possible before the spot turns red.
Yeah, it goes red and then it turns black. And that is when you'd better watch the German pilot girls in the St. Peter's dress. No, but it's not funny at all. In the reality perception, there is this tragic, and that is where it is. That's why I am doing only soft-cock porn now. These scenes where you just push it in with your thumb or a winkle bulb, and it is classic.
A lot of guys are down in vertebrate now. Damn, it's not easy to keep jelly when you're in a woman.
It's so much fun, soft cock. It's like trying to tighten up a screw with a naked. And keeping the lock in a sexy thread, that is very tricky. But I guess in the end, it's beating, squirting up your squid to death.
Thank you.
top, please. Excuse me.
Yeah?
Are these your birds?
No.
Yeah. Well, then, shut up.
Really? Oi, you lot, will you shut up?
Thanks.
No problem.
Welcome in Blue Jam.